Aki Kareem for British Boxing Television. I'm delighted to be joined by former world champion Barry Jones, and I'm really grateful that you've taken the time out of your busy schedule to talk to me today, Barry. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Busy schedule. I've literally chased two kids around all day. Actually, it's busy. I'd rather be in work. That's how hard it is.
Yeah.
Chased around all day. My partner is in her mother's. They got some health issues there, so she'd been there all day, and I'm literally just stuck with the kids, and I put them to bed, and it's just been
keeps you fit.
Punch in the face.
Do you enjoy being a father though and a family man?
I do. I love kids. Like, I know I've had kids late. I got a granddaughter. I got a daughter who's 26, and I got a granddaughter who's well. I've also got a son that's 4 and a daughter that's 2. So I've got a big range. So I do. I love kids, and you know, it keeps you young, and also drains the life out of you as well. So.
Well, talking of you being young, I just thought we could do a little trip down memory lane and look through your career. And I know you actually started boxing at the age of 10. Ray Thorogood's back at the Highfields gym a long time ago.
The Highfields it was. Yeah, Ray Thorogood was the name trainer, was the name on the door, if you like. But literally, to be honest, we either trained ourselves or there was other good guys came in. Malcolm Collins was world class amateur for Wales. He'd helped train us. My dad was one of them. Russell Ivins, Pat Manny, who ended up being the main coach at Splott, another big club in Cardiff. So we had a lot of guys, Tony Collins, we had a lot of guys coming in to help us out. Sort of Ray took a lot of credit that he probably didn't deserve, to be honest. But he still opened up every night and made it accessible to us. So, yeah, they were the best times. They really were. We had such a great schoolboy gym. It was just fantastic. It really was.
Coming, obviously, a proud Welshman as you are, rugby is a massive sport. I mean, a lot of kids in Wales, they go into rugby, really. So what pushed you away from rugby and into boxing?
I'm a midget.
You could have been a scrum half.
Well, back then I could have, but no, you couldn't. You got to be 6'2" to be a scrum half. I did like rugby. I played rugby. No, I wasn't great at it. My favourite sport was basketball.
Right.
Imagine. I mean, I wanted to be a basketball player. I loved it. I love it now. I watch it now. I subscribe more to Sky Sports or BT and then Sky Sports again now for the basketball more than the boxing, to be honest. I love it. I tape every game. My whole my recording on my machine is all full of basketball games, and that was the sport that I would have loved to be good at. Unfortunately, I had a few issues that were going to stunt while I wasn't going to be very good. But I played for my county as a kid. You know, I loved it. And I loved it because you're always involved. And that's what really endeared me to boxing. Because like other team sports, I was quite fast. So they put me on the wing, so you don't get to see much. They didn't teach kids back then like they do now, the skills of sports. So, now, if you were fast, you were just deemed as being pretty good. So they just let you run. But I can't play football. And same with rugby. I was scrum half for a while. Then they put me on the wing and I was fast. But that's boring. You don't get the ball. And other sports didn't really think. But basketball, you're always involved. Even when you don't have the ball, you're involved. And boxing, well, because you're always involved. Because you're either punching someone or trying to stop them from punching you. And more than the actual fighting, it was the training that really... I fell in love with.
Well, I'm sure there was a... you're listed as 5'7", I think, but I'm sure there was a 5'5" basketball player who could dunk called Muggsy Bogues. I'm sure was.
There's been a few small guys. There's a guy now who's 5'9", who plays. Yeah. Oh, good if you've got to be there, but you've got to be exceptionally good.
Yeah.
You have to be exceptionally good, and I wasn't that good. And also, it wasn't a sport. I'd still play it now. I play for Vets football. I'm rubbish. I'm so rubbish at football, you wouldn't believe. It's literally as if I'd never done any sport in my life. I'm like Forrest Gump. I just run everywhere. So I've got a great engine. My engine's really good. Even at this age now, when I don't really train at all, my engine is better than my fitness, if that makes any sense. I can keep going, even though I'm knackered. But I'm rubbish. I've got no skill. No one gives me the ball. So for the first... You put me up front for the first 5 minutes of the game. Everyone's going, oh, watch him, watch him. And then they realise, actually, He's just really shit. Like, he just runs around everywhere. But I'm a nuisance. But I play vet football. I play 5-a-side or 7-a-side in the week, and I would rather be basketball. If they had like a basketball team for older people where you just turn up and play, I'd do that because I love it. So this everyone's all about this Last Dance on Netflix, and I'm like, this is my sport. Were you all jumping on my bandwagon for my sport?
Yeah. Well, we're glad you stayed with the boxing because we wouldn't have the boxing stories over the years. And you know what a lot of people don't realize is actually you had a very pretty successful amateur career. You know, you won a European. I'm sure you won the European Championships.
Silver.
You competed in the World Championships. So you know you must have loved it, and you know you obviously applied yourself to it. And was it the discipline you loved about it? Was it the structure?
Yeah, I was a hyperactive kid. I wasn't I'm from a big council estate, you know. It's poverty stricken, of course, like everywhere. Most boxers come from the same sort of environment. But I wasn't that aggressive. So I got into trouble like every kid, but I wasn't, from where I was from, I was like a saint, to be honest. My older brother, on the other hand, was a raving lunatic and still is to this day, knocking 50 this year, and he's still a nutter. But, you know, but I loved the training. I was hyperactive. The training, I loved it so much that after I trained, leisure centre just started doing circuit training. It was like a new thing, and I used to go straight from the gym, put a black bag on and a sweatsuit, and go do circuit training for an hour. As a kid, I was just like, I think it stunted my growth. I think I should have been like 5'8", to be honest. But I loved it. I just loved it, getting involved, and the actual fighting wasn't so much. I wasn't really that aggressive in the ring, but it just the competing, that's all. And I, you know, like everyone, you want to win, and winning's everything. And every time you lose, I've cried every time I've lost. I haven't lost many fights, you know, throughout my life, but every time I've cried, I've lost. Every time I've lost, I've cried.
Yeah.
But I've never sulked, because you're in it to take that chance. So I always realised that. I was never sulky or competitive to a point where it would spoil my life. If I lost, I'd be devastated, but I'd get over it really quickly because I just wanted to do it again. So if I lost the top, like I lost in the European final against a good Ukrainian, and I was devastated. I went to the changing room and I cried my eyes out. Then I'm on a coach then, 2 days later, I boxed in the semi-finals of the ABAs against Alan Temple, a really good top-class amateur and a decent pro. And he beat me, actually. I lost 2 fights on the spin. I won a load of fights and I lost 2 fights on the spin. And then... But I didn't care about that. I did. I was gutted again. I cried again. But I was realistic. Well, I had to go. And I was like that as a professional. I wanted to win everything. But I was willing to take the fight. So if I would have lost, I'd accept it. You know, I won the sulker. So I didn't really have that raw aggression where, you know, I wanted to get back in and tear their head off. I just wanted to go in. The competitiveness, I've sort of gone way off target here. But the competitiveness of sport is what I love. You know, the actually being involved, not always the winning. Like, see, for example, when I play football, I never know what the score is. It's the weirdest thing. We could be 10-0 up or 10-0 down. I don't know. I don't take any notice. I know there's goals have been scored, but I'm so, like, I don't care. Because to me, it's irrelevant. Because my effort is the same whether we're 10-0 up or 10-0 down. I'm not gonna lay off. I'm going to try just as hard. So it doesn't matter to me. The only reason I get the ass ache in sports teams is when you're breaking your back and other people around you don't. And that's the thing about boxing. It's all on you. Can't blame no one else. And you can't point the finger at no one else because sometimes you'll look for someone to blame. I don't blame my coaches or my managers or my promoters for chucking me in fights when I wasn't ready. You know, moving up weights when I shouldn't have. The poor training facilities that I had throughout my career at times. That wasn't their fault. We worked with what we had. It all falls on me. So then those 12 rounds, 6 rounds, 3 rounds of fight night, whatever else, everyone else has helped you on the way, but ultimately it comes down to what you can do and how you do it. And that's why I always say, as great as trainers are, the boxer always makes the trainer. Always. It's a bit of a broad statement, but it's true, ultimately. It's down to the fighter. The trainer could be is worth his weight in gold, but if the fighter can't do it, he can't do it. And that's what I liked. It was always down to me.
Mm. And that sort of mentality you had may have accounted for a lot of your success, because, you know, you were known as a volume puncher. Barry McGuigan described you as a slick boxer. You were in and out. You weren't heavy-handed, but you buzzed around people and you really broke them down, and you were very accurate. So you didn't have that natural power, but you were still so successful. So maybe that was down to your mindset, perhaps.
Yeah, to be honest, every person who can punch will say the same thing. I could punch harder than my record suggested. I couldn't punch. I'm not a puncher. I was never going to be a puncher. I was never a puncher as an amateur. But the way I boxed meant I was never going to punch, because I was always looking to move back before I threw the shot.
Mm.
So, you know, I've never put no weight behind the punches. But some people like box have always gone, I can't believe you haven't stopped people. People like box have said that. Because I hit you with a good shot, because I was so... It was all about sports and never about business with me. So I always thought, if I've hit you with a good shot, I'm one nil up. That's where I see it. It's your new to chase me. Like, I was computer scoring before it happened, before computer scoring was invented, actually. I was way ahead of my time. But it was always a case of, I catch you when you've got to catch me back now. It's on you. And that's how it was. I was more aggressive as an amateur than I was as a pro, ironically.
Mm.
I wasn't aggressive, but I was tenacious. You know, I boxed people like Paul Samuels, like middleweight as a pro. 6 foot featherweight he was when I boxed him. And, you know, I couldn't dance around him. I had to go at him. I had to be tenacious. So I could do it. But as a pro, I got stuck into a rhythm of how I boxed. I had sort of some hard fights from the get-go.
Mm.
So rather than looking to evolve as a boxer, if you like, or adapt or transfer the things you do in the gym into the ring, because they were very competitive matches, I have to just win by all costs, by whatever means necessary. And that was usually just do what I'm good at, which is moving. And then, obviously, you just stick to that then. You don't really... So sometimes when people criticise these boxers that haven't journeymen, they know they're going to win, but it's to practice what you do in the gym to help you. When you get in a more competitive fight, you'll do that. If you just chuck into the competitive fights, like my first fight that came was 3-0 with 2 knockouts, my first fight. You didn't turn out to be a world beater, but when you're 18, without the internet or YouTube, you couldn't see who you boxed. Then, you know, that's a fight where you just think, "Poof, I better just do what I'm good at and just win. Don't worry about practice and stuff. I'll just win." And so that's probably stunted my development a little bit as a pro.
You turned over young, you know, you turned over at the age of 18, and which is kind of normal back in the 80s and 90s, really. But, you know, given the fact that you actually went on to have a relatively short career because of, you know, things that we'll talk about later on with your brain scans, you know, were you glad that you turned over at a young age?
No, I'm not. Because we talk about the brain scans that played there, but I don't think it would have been a problem if I would have been 3 years down the line. You know, if I would have got that level, and then that scans would have been a problem. So, I think I should have turned pro on 97 when I won the world title. To be honest, I turned pro at 18, and I never got my man strength till about 28. I had my last fight at 25, so I never got my man strength while I was boxing. You know, so some people like Naz got their man strength at you know, when they were like 7. You know, and so that's just the way it is. And I never, you know, I never did. So I matured late. And so I turned pro too young. It was no one's fault, my fault. I got asked to turn pro, and I went, okay. There was no thought behind it. I didn't have no ambition at that time to turn pro. I'm very much just go with the flow type of guy. I'm a weird, like, I've had loads of bad luck, but I've loads of good luck as well. It's weird. I sort of go, my whole life goes like that.
Yeah.
You know, I won the world title, but then I lose it because of the scans, you know, but I turning pro was never. I wanted to be Sugar Ray Leonard, like every kid in the 80s wanted to be Sugar Ray Leonard, who was into boxing. But I never really thought I had a plan to turn pro or when I was going to turn pro. It was like I was an apprentice electrician. I didn't want to be an electrician. The guy behind my house had a little van with a couple of guys, and he shouted over the fence and said, "When you leave school," I said, "this summer." He said, "Do you want to work for me?" And I said, "Yes." And I said, "Oh, what do you do?" He said, "I'm an electrician." I said, "Oh, brilliant." And then I went to work on the Monday, and then I did an apprenticeship, and that was pretty much how I turned pro. Do you want to turn pro? I went, yeah, right then. And then my manager Billy Hayes met me at the hotel by an airport. I was on the way to the World Championships actually. My son just before that, and he gave me my dressing gown and my shorts and my boots. That was my signing on fee. Leather boots, mind.
Nice.
The only boots I ever had as a pro, by the way.
Yeah.
Only had one pair of boots. And and that was it. And then I turned pro. And then I come home from Canada from the World Championships and said to my dad, I've turned pro. And he said, what the fuck have you done? What's the matter with you? You've got the Commonwealth Games in 2 years' time. You know what I mean? It was just like, you get a medal there and possibly a good chance you get a medal. And that'll be on BBC One and it'll change your life. And because back then, winning the Commonwealth was a big deal. Now, the amateurs are so good now in Britain that the Commonwealth Games is almost like a training tournament for them, isn't it, really? But you know, no one was winning medals in big Olympics back then, so winning a medal in the Commonwealth Games was a springboard to a big promoter when you turn pro.
And you turned over with Pat Thomas, who himself was a former British champion. And, you know, how did you sort of select a trainer, or did he select you? Did you select him? How did that process happen?
It was Pat and Billy Head. Billy Head was an ex-heavyweight, a good heavyweight, Billy. And a very colourful character. But I never met Billy. Even my manager, I never met him. Weirdest thing. Yeah, crazy, isn't it? Never met him until after I signed up. But Pat Thomas was a good fighter, a two-way British champion. And he was just coming down my amateur gym. That's all, and just getting involved. But he was such a beautiful mover. Like, you could stand in front of you like a Hello Graham type. Actually, he lost his British title, one of his British titles, to Hello Graham, as it goes.
That's right. And the other one was to Chris Pyatt, I think, maybe later on.
Yeah, he lost to Chris later on, yeah.
Yeah.
But he was brilliant. He'd stand in front of you, he'd make you miss. He'd dip and slide and slip, and you know, and you just go, wow. What did he do there? And then he just said, you're really good, you are. And he really zoned in on all the kids in the gym. He zoned in on me. And then, so he sort of poached me, really. That's what he did, inadvertently. Like, I don't think he was any malice behind it. To be fair, he genuinely thought I'd be a world champion. I never won a world title with him, unfortunately. And I think if I would have stayed with him, I wouldn't have won one. Mm. But he believed, it was all about belief for him. It wasn't so much about money. I hope not. Like, you know, he never took a penny off me, nor did Billy, to his credit. I wasn't earning any money, but still, they still never took nothing. You know, they were waiting for the big payout, which never happened, unfortunately.
Yeah, well, you must have had a lot of favour with Frank Warren, though, because you got put on a lot of good cards, actually. I remember you fought on an undercard of a big Eubank fight.
That wasn't a Warren card.
That was probably Barry Hearn.
Hearn and Don King, I think. Yeah. But that was a weird. I got on some cards in Wales, like Floyd Haver when he boxed for the world title, things like that, because I sold lots of tickets. So, you know, it was a no brainer. I sold lots of tickets, and you pay me peanuts to fight. So that was back then, crowds would stay to watch the main event. You know, nowadays, an undercard fight, they leave, don't they, mostly, unless it's a huge event. But that Old Trafford one came across. I was stood in a rugby club at about 1 o'clock in the morning, the Saturday before, having, maybe, was it curry and chips? I can't remember. But it was, because there was a fight in the old Cardiff Arms Park Stadium. It was Bruno versus Lewis. And it was on link because for American TV. And I'm sulking because, you know, there's a massive fight in Cardiff. A huge fight, a heavyweight fight, an all British, if you can call Lennox British, an all British heavyweight title fight, which is almost unheard of. And I couldn't even get on the bill. Mm. Joe Calzaghe had his debut. I already had four fights, I think, by then, or five fights. And I couldn't, and I was really gutted. Then I had a phone call. I remember I had one of those dodgy mobile phones that you pay like £20 for, and it could last 6 months or 6 hours.
Yeah, a gangster phone. Yeah.
Well, they were all fat. They were about that thing back then. But you just buy it off your mate, and it lasts as long as it lasts. Got a phone call saying, "Do you want to box next Saturday?" And they said, "Where?" He said, "In Old Trafford on Ben and Newman." I said, "Yes." I just said, "Yeah." I didn't know who I was fighting. It didn't matter who I was fighting because I wouldn't have known him anyway. It turned out to be an undefeated kid called John White, who I didn't know he was any good. I never met John White. I can't ever remember. I don't know what he looks like. I can't remember seeing him at the weigh-in. I obviously seen him in the night on the ring, and I beat him quite comprehensively on points. I dropped him, actually. I remember because they were practicing the... It was like, you know, it was like 40,000 people there, but when I boxed, it was probably 10,000. Mm. By the way, back then, they didn't have a 20 card, undercard event. It was five fights. That's all there were, five fights. So I'm one of only 10 people at the boxing Old Trafford, as crazy as it goes. But it wasn't... And I, anyway, the guy who went, one, two, because it was sort of empty, you could hear them on the microphone, and you could hear some of the commentary practice, sometimes do a little practice run, and the Americans, you could hear them. So it was crazy, but I boxed him, and then I remember speaking to Robin Reed years later, and he was telling me how good John White was. Mm. He was undefeated when I boxed him, but I can't remember him being good. He might have been, but I just remember I boxed really well, and I think he was a bit of a puncher, according to Robin Reed, but I just didn't keep still long enough for him to hit me.
That
was sort of how my career went. You know, I turned on one fight in my life, as it goes. And that was only because it was sort of underhanded. There was a Welsh promoter offered me a promotional contract. He said, I'll get you one of those WBC international titles. They were brand new. Those international titles were brand new back then. So I go, well, a belt or something, I'll take it. And he phoned me up a couple of weeks later saying, I got a fight for you in South Africa. But it's next week. Mm-hmm. I said, okay. It was 9 stone, but I was making 9 stone easy back then. I should have been a super bantamweight, but I wanted to be a featherweight because especially for Welsh boxers, the history of featherweight is I wanted to be Howard Winston. I loved Howard Winston. Yeah. So I should have been super bantamweight though. But anyway, I was featherweight. Weight wasn't a problem, especially for a week's notice. So I said, yes, I'll take it. And then my boxing, they gave me the name of the kid. But there was no box rec then. There was the internet wasn't really a working thing back then. And then, so I phoned up a guy who used to work for the local paper on the boxing news and give him the guy's name, because I was told the guy I was boxing had 15 fights, 1-8, something like that, you know, like 3 knockouts. It turned out he was like something like 14-0 with 11 knockouts.
Right.
It was a fellow called Cassius Bellue. Now, Cassius Bellue ended up to be a 2-8 world champion.
Yeah.
He's like a 6-foot featherweight. So, the chances I might not beat him anyway. But I'm not going to beat him in South Africa if he's good.
Yeah.
So I said no. That was the only fight I've ever turned down. And then I phoned him and said, no, I'm not doing that. And it was £2,000, which wasn't even good money back then. To be honest, right. 93 or 4 or something. And I went, no, thank you. That was my first taste of a bit of, this is not very nice, this. Mm. They're telling me one thing, and the reality is, you know, you might smash me up. And plus, I got to go to South Africa and box the next day, pretty much what it would have been. You know, so no acclimatizing, just turn up, fight, and go home. And that's how it was. You had to trust the people who were looking after you.
Yeah.
And hope they were looking after you. So, needless to say, I didn't sign a promotional contract, but I have no hard feelings towards that particular promoter because he was just trying to make fights and make money like they all were. So that's all it was.
You were never a flashy sort of guy. I mean, you mentioned that you sold a lot of tickets, but you weren't like a cocky guy. You barely even cared about ring music, all that sort of stuff. So why was it that you managed to sell a lot of tickets?
I'm good looking. Everyone laughs when I say that, but it was a combination. My dad worked for the council, so, and he was an electrician, but I think he might have been a contracts manager by then. I think he worked his way up. I'm not sure if he was, but either way, our local pub. So when I was a kid, you hung around in a gang outside the shop called the Top Shop Boys. That's terrible. It sounds like a no, a little bit of a sort of gay cult in there, but and then right next to that parade of shops was a pub called the Cavalier. So you would sort of go from the shops when you got to older if you go to the pub. So we had a massive gang of people and it was just fantastic. It was great times, absolute lunatics, all of them. And so I had a lot of friends from that. My brother was a Cardiff City boy, one of those football boys. So we had a lot of mates. So most of my tickets were sold from my dad and his work friends, the guys in the pub, and my brother's mates. So that was, and obviously my friends. But when you're 18, you know that many people. Yeah. You don't, especially when you're 18 years into sports. But luckily, yeah, I was from a city, so even though I was always like someone like Joe Calzaghe, didn't know anybody because they're from Newbridge. Newbridge is a tiny little place. It's almost.
I know. Like, I went and visit him there, and I can see it's a tiny little place.
some of those valleys are streets. They're just streets almost, pretty much, with few streets off them. So when people say, you know, Wales is a hard, like promoters don't like going to Wales because it's a hard sell, but they just see it. They just see Joe's from Cardiff, he's from Cardiff, and they're not. They're from the Gavin Rees from Cardiff. They're not from Cardiff. They're outside of Cardiff, so it's hard to sell tickets. But I was from a city, so, and also you don't get like carried away with what's going on. So, because I'm from a city, I grew up seeing city things, people taking drugs. You know, so I made that choice when I was like 14 that I wasn't going to do drugs. So it was easy to be around people taking drugs. Mm-hmm. Where when you're sort of shielded away when you're into sports and you live out in the sticks. And then all of a sudden you become a decent name and you start going into the city and start clubbing. Then you see all these things with people taking gear and stuff like that. And they just go, what's going on here? And you get carried away with it all, you know? But if you grow up around it, then it's not an issue. So that was, I don't know where all that come from. But yeah, so the fact that, you know, where I grew up, that pub really was how I sold tickets. But you know what? Another thing, and kids, obviously after this lockdown, of course, things go back to normal, whenever that's going to be. Selling tickets is social media is a great weapon to advertise yourself. But that won't sell you tickets at the grassroots level. Grassroots level is going to the pub, going to the barbers, going to the post office, your local shop, and say, can I put a poster up, please? Can I put tickets up? And I tell kids this and ask them if they can put 10 tickets behind the counter, if you can put a poster up, and then whatever happens after the fight, when you go and collect the tickets, after your fight, go back and say thank you. Even if they haven't sold the ticket, say thank you. I really appreciate your effort and support. And you know, would it be okay if I come back again with my next fight? Because they will. And that's what I did. And my father taught me that very young. Mm. He taught me more about, don't forget to go back and thank him. And I go, but they didn't sell any tickets. He said, but they held them for you. And they'll do it next time. And they make an effort. The more they like you and they see you're a nice young kid and you make an effort and you're polite, they'll go, I've seen, and someone goes, that post, they go, oh, he's a lovely kid, you should go and watch him. Or they'll buy a ticket to watch. Because, by the way, some people would buy tickets and wouldn't go. Just to buy a ticket. Oh, let's buy a ticket for him, you know, let's buy a ticket for him. And so it was, I think that's a good lesson for young kids today. You've got to, it's got to be old-fashioned by foot. It's horrible and it's hard, but that's just unfortunately how it has to be done. But that's how you build up a fan base. And I think, you know, Josh Warrington is the perfect example.
Yeah, we followed him on a ticket run. We actually followed him doing the ticket run. And it was great to see. He still does it now, you know, even as a decorated world champion. It's great to see.
He has to do it now almost more than ever, because otherwise the perception of him now will be, oh, yeah, especially because, you know, when you're from a council state or whatever, it will be, oh, look at him, full of himself now. Don't come round you anymore. And it'll change quickly. Chinese whispers, all of a sudden, you're arrogant up your own ass. So I think now he has to do it more than ever now to keep that, he's still one of us. I think that's very important.
Yeah.
I think he's hyped from the same area as me.
Yeah.
More or less, you know, a little bit of a nicer area, but it's pretty much the same as me. He went to a rough school, to be fair, Nicky, intelligent boy. But he took, and understandably, and I don't know Nicky that well, but he took the sort of corporate route from day one. And financially, it was a better fit for him and the right idea, and he sold tickets and he was a fan, but they didn't love him like they love me. Mm. They didn't love him like they love Steve Robinson.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? Like, by the way, me and Steve at one point in our lives were from the same street.
Yeah,
we lived in the same street. Me and Steve when we were kids. I didn't know him, but we lived in the same street for a few years. But but people love Steve.
Yeah,
and they love me to an extent because of that. Because we stayed one of theirs.
Mm.
Still go out. Now, I was a world champion, still dropping people in because I don't drink. I didn't drink since I'm from 17. I haven't a drink of alcohol. So I was still dropping my mates to nightclubs, to the city centre and back when I was a world champion.
Yeah.
And older people, my dad's mates. You know, we go from one pub to the next pub sometimes. So the Cavalier would close at 11, but then the West End, because it was a social club, would stay open until 12. So I would drop some of my dad, I would drop them down. I'll drop you down. I'm going to be silly. Like, you know, I was like, you know, the most famous taxi driver in Cardiff, like, in many ways. But then they loved me for that, and they loved me to this day now for that. You know, and I remember Barry used to drop us wrong. And I won when I was 16, so I was a world champion 23, 24. So
yeah,
the effort you have to make with your community is very important to sell tickets. And
You've mentioned this, all this. It sounds great, you know, and how you built this following up. And one thing I've never really known about you, you took a year out and you ended up going to Ireland for a year. Now, I can't find that documented anywhere about the actual reasons behind that. And I don't know if you'd care to share it with us or mind.
I had a daughter, young, with a lovely girl, Helen, and we were young when we met. She was younger than me, so, you know, and she wasn't from Cardiff. Her father was working. He was like a health and safety guy for the mines. Had a very good job as it goes. And they lived in a place called Colbridge, a nice part of just outside Cardiff. And I met her. You know, she met up with some friends from the school from my area, and we met up and we got together and then I got her pregnant quite young, quite quick as well. No messing around, see. And then unfortunately, then, you know, it was always a battle because it wasn't the right environment for her. She hadn't grown up. We were living above a shop in a flat. It was fine for me, but I think for her, it was a bit of a struggle. So we inevitably split up, and she went back to Chester with my daughter. And it was a hard time, but too hard to take. Too hard to worry about boxing. Plus, my 3 years with Pat Thomas and Billy Aird had come to an end. So I didn't sign up with those, and I thought it was a good time just to take a break. And obviously my daughter was the main thing. I mean, me and the Pat and the mother split up and they went back to Chester. So it was hard. I couldn't think about boxing. I couldn't think about, you know, anything else. My 3 years with Pat Thomas and Billy Aird, my managerial contract had expired. I chose not to sign back up with them. As much as they were lovely people, I just don't think they could have took me where I needed to go or where I wanted to go. Through no fault of their own, by the way, but that's just the way it was. And just with the break and everything else, it was a... And also my mother's partner at the time was working in Ireland, fireproofing a shopping centre in Blanchardstown outside the Dublin. It was good money. It was £1,000 a week. Take home. And believe me, this is like 95, 96. Yeah. So, I went. I went, oh, this ain't going to go. And I was finished with boxing. I saw... And a few things. I beat Neil Swain, and then he went and won a Commonwealth title at the weight below, and then I never, you know, and I was sort of not. I was happy for him, but envious that, well, how come he's getting the opportunity? And I beat him. You know, I sort of beat about four undefeated kids in my first 11, 12 fights or something. I beat Michael Devenny. He went out to win a British title. You know, I was like, well, how come everyone's getting? I boxed a 10 round eliminator for a British title. Mm-hmm. I took it at a day's notice. I ended up with this cauliflower ear because of it, against an undefeated kid called Justin Murphy, and I beat him, and I got nothing for it except a deformity. I didn't get a British title shot, and then Michael Devenny wins the British title. So it's like that, all that added together, and the main thing being my daughter being, you know, the 300 miles away, was enough. So I went off. I just went, and it was the best thing I did. To be honest, I was still young. It didn't matter. It didn't really affect my career as such. But I wasn't boxing again. I was earning good money, and I was out there. I had hair. I had Liam Gallagher hair. I loved hair. And I had a good time. I had a good time. You know, I did what a young single man would do. I enjoyed myself. And it was great. I was earning good money. But then I went all of a sudden. I went on this. We used to play football in the break time and dinner time. And I was really fit, like really fit. So I'd run around like a lunatic and stuff. And someone said, he's fit, isn't he? I said, he used to be a boxer. He's a boxer. And then someone mentioned this club. And I went on this amateur club. And they had one of their junior champions. So when he was about 19 at the time. And I'm like 21, 22. And he tried to put it on me. And I knocked him out. I feel sorry for that kid now because he'd be knocked out by me. Right. Pack in. And even though I was embarrassed about it, you know, but then I thought, well, what am I doing? And I went home. And I literally, I'd done another sort of 3 weeks over in Dublin. And I went home, and then I look, and then at the time, Ronnie Rush had just opened the gym in my council estate called Ely in Cardiff, just opened the boxing gym. So I went down there, started to train. Didn't have a trainer. My dad was helping me out. My dad, you know, taught me more than anyone else. He never really my full trainer, but he taught me more than anyone. So he was training me, and then I just have people come in my corner for two fights. I had nobody. And then, Ronnie Rush said, "Listen, do you want me to train you?" And I said, "Well, maybe. I don't care. I don't know. You know, I didn't go scouting for anyone." And he said, "I can get you signed up with Frank Warren." And then we drove to London, met Frank in a hotel. He said, "Yeah, I'll give you a couple of fights if you're good. I'll give you a title fight. If you when I was into continental things, you defend that a couple of times, I'll give you a world title shot." I go, "That sounds good." So he didn't really give a shit. Like, I was just like 14 and 0, so he thought I'll sign him anyway. And had my first fight with Frank Warren then, about a few months later, and I got a draw. It was terrible. Like, I'm honest, if I got beat, or I had some close calls, some fights I had some close calls, I did. But that wasn't. That was a farce. It was David Morris. I used to spar with David. And so I knew, and not the kid's fault, but it was an easy fight. I didn't enjoy many fights because I couldn't punch. So every fight I had to be switched on with. But that fight was an enjoyable fight for me. It really was. Because it was easy. I played with him. And anyway, it was a draw. Like, it was, I think the boxing is put the worst decision of the year or something like that in the write-up. But that was my first meeting with Frank Warren. And then my next fight, they phoned me up and said, like, in March, do you want to box for an IBF Intercontinental? And I said, yes. Why wouldn't I say yes? It's a title shot. When is it? It's next month. That's fine. That's no problem. He said, super featherweight. I was seriously thinking then about going down to super bantamweight because, you know, super bantamweight was a good division then. Spencer Oliver was flying at the time. And I thought, that's what I should be. I'd be a big super feather. But I was a featherweight, so super featherweight. And we had a chat, my dad, and it was a kid called Peter Judson, who didn't have a great record, Peter, but he was a tough, nasty, nasty man. And he just beat Dean Phillips from Swansea area. Dean was touted as an undefeated prospect, big puncher, and Judson knocked him out. And in a real good war. And so that was my opponent. And we just said, yes, my father says, just take the chance. Again, not afraid to lose, take the chance. And if I lose, then I lose in the wrong weight. And I'll go back down to featherweight and then super bantamweight, and we'll see where we go. And if you win, then you have a title. You can go back down to featherweight or super bantamweight with a bit of a bargaining chip on your shoulders. So that was it. I boxed Peter, went up to Sheffield, boxed Peter. And to be fair to Peter, he was the champion, but they treated me like the home fighter, which wasn't fair, to be honest. I got the win. It was a hard fight. I thought I'd won, but he thought he won as well. And it was a good fight, actually, you know, thanks to Peter, because he just chased me down like a lunatic. I got the win there. Then I got a defence of that a couple of months later. I remember saying I wanted to box Paul Ingle. He was British champion at featherweight. And then he would have beat me, by the way, Paul, but still, I wanted to box. You know, I wanted to be a British featherweight champion and then go down to look for Spencer Oliver for the European title. And I beat a fellow called Afi Djelti, French Algerian, and he could punch you. He's real horrible, gangly style. And I beat him. That turned out to be my best win of my career, as it goes, as a professional. But then, because I beat him, I ended up being like number 10 or 11 in the world. And then, because he had some good wins, and he was rated in the IBF. And then things took off from there. Then really, that was it. Like. I'm stuck in the wrong weight, but I'm winning. So what am I going to do?
Well, were you surprised when you got the shot at Wilson Palacio? Is that how you pronounce his name? Palacio?
Yeah, Palacios. Yeah, hugely surprised because I didn't deserve a world title shot the way I saw it. Like, I'm too honest about my career, and I have to sort of stop saying it too much because no one else says it about theirs. But so many of us are lucky to get world title shots. It's the generation we were born into, luckily, because if all us fighters were born in the 80s, I'm not saying we wouldn't be good fighters, but we wouldn't be world champions. And that's that. You can go to like 90% of the world champions we've had in Britain wouldn't be world champions. Not saying they're not good fighters, or not saying they're not world class, but they wouldn't be world champions. There's more opportunities, more belts, and there's more scope to sneak in and box inferior opposition for world titles. So I guess Palacios, again, 3 weeks notice. That's fine. Again, because weight wasn't an issue. I walked around at 9'7", and I had to weigh 9'4". So my gimmick at weigh-ins was chewing a Mars bar, eating a Mars bar at the weigh-in, because I never struggled to make the weight. But then also, the flip side of that, 28 hours later or 30 hours later, at the actual fight night, you know, when you get in the ring, I'm still 9'7", and they're 10'7". Because my last guy, was like 11'7", or whatever he was. He was huge. So, you know, back then, you could weigh what you wanted to. But I didn't box great against Palacios, to be fair. He banged me in the shoulder in the first couple of rounds, and I couldn't do my combination punching as I used to be quite effective with. But I boxed quite well, but not enough to win. And they were all sort of close. It was one of those rounds where every round was close, but I was just winning every round. That was sort of my style, to be honest. Just do enough.
Yeah.
A very frustrating style to train, I would imagine. So you'd see me in the gym and I'd be great. You knew what I could do. I'm not saying I was an all-time great, but I would just do enough in the ring. I thought too much. My brain got in the way. You see great fighters, they know when to disengage their brain and go for it. And my brain was always thinking about the next move, and almost not concentrating on the move in hand. And that could be a problem. Yeah. So my boxing bit.
Quite wide on the scorecards, didn't you? I mean, I think you won 118-110 on two cards.
Yeah, I did, but it was a closer fight than that. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
One of those fights where I say it when I commentate that it's one of those fights where you can just win every round, but it don't do the guy justice. I think that people go mad about it, but when you break, it's not. See, a title fight is not a 12 round fight. It's 12 to a judge. It's 12 1 round fights. Because he has scored it red blue, that card goes away, and he's supposed to forget about that round. And then it's red blue again. Could be different boxers theoretically. He has to judge it like that. So you can't say, "Oh, I give maybe 5 close rounds, but I give the last 3 to him, so I'll give him the next 2." You have to judge everyone by his merit. And if you just think he's done enough, then he's just done enough. So you have a fight that's a ding dong every round. There's punch per punch. You have 120-108. Makes no sense, but that's how the scoring works. So I was world champion, 23 years of age, out of nowhere, in the wrong weight. I was a champion of the world. And I was a champion because I just took the opportunity. That's all. I got a phone call from Ernie Fossey. He's dead now. Do you want to box for a world title? I almost told him to fuck off, to be honest. Sorry. I almost told him to get lost because I thought he was winding me up. And that was it. But the funny thing about that story is that I was in a dinner show. Again, I had another one of those dodgy phones. I was in a dinner show in Bridgend at an amateur show. Got the phone call from my dad, and then we're panicking. Who is it? Because the IBF champ, because again, there's no real internet back then, so you had to look at the boxing news or the boxing monthly. So we had the boxing monthly, we had the latest ratings, and it was Arturo Gatti was still champion. So I'm over the moon. I'm presuming I'm IBF Intercontinental champion. I have a high rating with the IBF. So I'm boxing the IBF champion. That's what you presume. So I'm boxing Arturo Gatti. My head's going. I'm like, oh, unbelievable.
Yeah.
Arturo Gatti at super featherweight was better than any other weight. So he would have battered me. But I'm in it, tonight. I don't care. I'm boxing for a world title against a good guy like that. Why do I care? I'll go for it. I might have to go away for it. And that's an exciting prospect. And then... Then my father said, I think he's moved up. I think he's moving up. I'm sure he's moving up. So number one was a very old Azuma Nelson. I'm like, oh, I'm going to box Azuma Nelson. He'll kill me, probably, manslaughter. But who cares? I'm boxing Azuma Nelson. And I'm that, and you fantasize there, because to be a boxer, you have to be an eternal dreamer. You couldn't do the sport otherwise. From where you come from to where some people end up, it's in fact, you just would never happen in any other walk of life. So I'm dreaming about if Azuma Nelson has the worst night of his life, and I have the best night of my life times 10, I could somehow beat him. And then people will remember that he's 75 with one eye. Remember, I beat Azuma Nelson. End of story. That's it. I beat legitimate all-time great to win my world title. It don't matter. I'm cemented in the history. I made it. I'm Sugar Ray Leonard in my bedroom when I was 9 or 10 years of age. All that's coming true. No. The reality would have been that I would have went in there and done my best and, you know, and got battered in five rounds probably. But even still, it turned out not to be that. It turned out not to be the IBF title even. It was a lightweight from Colombia boxing a featherweight from Cardiff for the super featherweight title. It's crazy boxing is, but it changed my life. It changed my life though. You know, that phone call, me saying yes without even asking a question, or I didn't ask who, where, how much, or when. I didn't know when it was, who it was, where, or how much, or what weight. I didn't have a clue. I just said yes. And do you want to box for the world title? Yes.
Yeah.
Don't worry about the details later. Aren't we all in it to box for the world title?
Yeah.
Isn't that the end game? No, we all want to be rich. I understand all that. We all want to loads of money, and I do understand that. And if you're fortunate enough to have a gold medal in the Olympics and have that proper structure where you can plan it and you're earning big money, so why would you take a fight? Or you're a heavyweight where, why would I box for the world title for 2 million when I can get 6 million for boxing someone else? I would still take the 2 million and try and win a world title. But you know, but that, I understand that this, the way society's become now, people have different priorities. But for me, it was never about the money. I wanted to be a world champion or a champion. That was it. And then the further you go up, the more the Welsh and British and all that bypasses you, and you're looking at the bigger picture. So, world title, I do it for nothing. I did it for nothing. I practically did do it for nothing, but to be fair, I like Frank Warren gets slated left, right, and centre, like all managers and promoters do, and sometimes they deserve it. But I can't say nothing but thank you to Frank Warren. Well, he didn't do it for me, but I benefited from his decisions. I won a world title. I had a world title shot thanks to him, not down to my merits. And that's quite often for most fighters, to be honest. Not all, you know, you're still fighting. You still have to beat who's in front of you. But most of the time, it's the guys in the back rooms who make you all pulling the strings to get, like, or going to the conventions and lobbying. It's a problem for our sport, actually, but that's what they do. And that's so... I got nothing but praise for Frank Warren. How could I do anything else? He made me a champion of the world. I had to fight for it, of course, but I got my opportunity.
Were you sad that, you know, obviously you reached the pinnacle, you know, out of nowhere you become the world champ. Were you kind of sad that it was quite short-lived, because that's when, you know, it started taking that downturn and the brain scan stuff started to come in? Like, what was that like for you?
Oh, it was like winning a lottery ticket, walking towards Camelot offices, knocking the door, and then the wind blowing the ticket out of your hand.
It was
literally like that. You're like, fucking, I know. On one minute I'm looking for houses, next minute I'm looking to sign on. It wasn't quite like that, but you know, it's like, it blew my world apart. It was, I had such a high. I couldn't believe it. The night I won the world title, I went to bed and I had the belt at the bottom of my bed in the hotel, in the London Arena. And the belt with the bottom, I think it was the Intercontinental. The belt with the bottom of my bed. And when I woke up, I had about 2 hours sleep, and I woke up and I kept my eyes closed and I was looking, trying to feel for the belt with my feet. I looked with my feet to see if it was real. I couldn't believe it was real. I was just, and then all of a sudden, within like a month or like 8 weeks or something, 6-7 weeks, it went from like the best feeling to the worst feeling. It's like, I couldn't believe my luck. I thought, mate, now it's time to cash in. That's what I'm thinking. I had a nice. I went to Paris as well for a press conference. I had a fight. I was going to fight a fella called Julian Lawsey, a really good fighter. And I'm in Paris. They stopped the traffic in the Champs-Élysées for me and him to walk past, to me and to do a head-to-head.
Mm.
It's like stopping traffic in Oxford Street. It was unbelievable. Yep. It was just like, I couldn't believe it. No, me and my dad flew like a 16-seater plane to Paris, and then came back the same day. It was just fucking unbelievable. I mean, it's like, this is my life now. This is my life. And then it all went wrong, and that was difficult. And also people patting you on, like saying, "Oh, listen, Barry, you know, they're sitting around with you betting off not boxing. And people who didn't know anything, and then, you know, like, didn't know the story, didn't know about it. Originally, I was just worried for my health. I didn't care about the world title. Well, is there something wrong with me? Am I going to die? Am I going to be, you know, mentally disabled? You know, is it, what is it? You know, what is it? Because, by the way, I got a phone call, third-party phone call, about my medical condition. Wasn't even a straight phone call from the boxing board. They phoned up Warren's office, and Warren's office phoned up my dad, and my dad told me.
Yeah.
So like, how can that be right? But anyway, it was a long. I don't. The boxing ball were wrong. That's all. They were wrong. They were wrong for the right reasons. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They wanted to do what they don't want them to get hurt, and they're the best organization for health. You know, for looking after the health and safety of boxers. But at that particular time, they were wrong. And if I was Nazim Hamid, or if I was Lennox Lewis, or Joe Calzaghe, or Bruno, or whoever was world champion at that time, if one of the bigger names, that wouldn't have happened. I know, but the condition I had, the problem with the brain scan, which technically wasn't a problem, and it was never a failed brain scan. That's what's quite important. It shouldn't have been an issue. It was a change in my scan, because MRI scans were brand new in 1997. So we used to have CT scans, and MRI scans were brand new in 1997. And then in 1998, that was the first time they could compare scans. Now, those MRI scans are 10 times, 100 times more detailed than CAT scans. I don't know them exactly, but they're more detailed. So they see things that you would normally see. And so there was a change in my scan. I don't want to go massively into it. I can if you like, but I think I drag out the story enough as it is. And then, true. Yeah, but that was it. So, and they were in the wrong. And the worst part is I went back there with all the information to prove that there wasn't a real issue. To be fair, we didn't really know. But to prove that they couldn't prove there was an issue. After I went to see a doctor, and I went to see a brain surgeon who said, as far as I'm concerned, you know, there's no more danger than any other boxer in the country. So that was good enough for me. But I went there with all the right information, and they said no. And that's when I lost my world title. And that's when I should have sued them. I would have had a good case. I would have won. I'm pretty sure I would have won. My barrister said I should have sued them, and I never. I should have sued for loss of earnings, you know, defamation of character as well. That was a big thing, you know. And people thinking I've got brain damage. That's what it was. I had a massive horrible story a couple of years later that went on the front pages of one of the Sunday newspapers. I made the front pages. For all the wrong reasons.
For the wrong reasons, yeah.
Brain damaged boxer allowed to fight on. So that's what it was. There was a retraction then about the week later. Well, obviously, I think Warren got his legal eagles onto it. There was a retraction, like page 14, about that big. You know, but the damage was done. I'm damaged good. So the boxing board don't want me to fight, even though I got my license back. To be honest, though he's never said it, but Frank Warren probably don't want me to fight, because why does he want to even risk something happening? And a lot of people didn't want to see me fight. I can understand that, but it was hard, and I fell out of love. It killed me inside. Mm-hmm. I lost my love for boxing.
Yeah.
And that's why after the Freitas fight, I packed it in more than anything. There was another issue with my scan, to be fair, but it was just an issue that wouldn't be no problem to overcome. There was another change. But they had nowhere to stand on. I would have got my license back. But I just thought, I can't do this again. It was all about money. Because I kept thinking about the money I lost. Those 2 years I was out, pretty much 18 months. If I would have kept winning, that's like, back then, for me, that's like 4 or 5 defences. It's not like, no, but if I won twice a year, I'm boxing 3 times a year, at least. So, you know, I'm earning good money. And my contract then, I don't see how much it was, but it was better than what most kids are getting out of my weight. It was really good money. And it's only that good because they don't think you're going to get that far down the road. It gets bigger every fight. So the more the big money is at the end of the contract. But it was realistic, I thought. But I never got it. So I never got it, never earned it. So I don't miss it now. I would have spent it by now on, you know, strippers and jumpers and trainers. Well, yeah.
Money well spent. But it's a real shame, though, because when you did fight Freitas, you know, that's a guy you probably could have swerved, really, but you had to fight him because he was the champ by then. And he was a big bruise in 20. He was 23-0 with 23 knockouts when you fought him. Yeah. And he went to become a two-weight world champ. He was the real deal. And, you know, it was just a shame you had to... I actually remember watching that fight and thinking, okay, the guy outgunned you, clearly outgunned you, but you showed a lot of bravery and a lot of heart. So you must have had your mind still in the game a little bit, because to get up off those shots, you know, you kept going and kept going.
See, people... like, I got more credit for that fight than I did for any other fight. Mm. All the wins I had. But, and I understand why I can even as a trier. But I don't see it as, what am I going to do? Sit down? So, you know, I was out of the sport before that fight, to be honest. I got no excuse. I got loads of excuses why I lost that fight. He never made the weight. He never made the weight. I tell you, the sky with it, he never made the weight. It was ridiculous. Mm. The British boxing ball guy was stood over the corner eating bloody gummy bears or something. You weren't even watching. And he never made the weight. You know, I didn't spar. I'd had one fight in 2 years. That was 6 months before. But the real reason I lost that fight is because it was just too good for me. So I didn't make an excuse after the fight, because I knew that guy's beating me, whatever happens. Even if I never lost the license and I'd had five defences, he still beats me. He was too good. Just too good. He was too fast, too powerful, too big. Just too good for me. Too good. But I'm proud of myself, because I've never been on the floor in my life. But he knocked me down six times, but I got up six times.
Yeah.
And I got credit, and I'm proud of myself. You don't know how you're going to react. Like the first knockdown, I don't really count that, because it was a genuine knockdown. But I don't count that as having to dig deep, because I didn't feel it. He just caught me with the right hand. No. And I didn't see it, and it knocked me on my ass. I wasn't hurt. I was happy I did the right thing. I didn't jump up. I took the eight count on my knee, and I got up. But then the body shot he hit me with in the first round, and cracked the rib straight away. And some of the head shots I didn't go down with. I was talking to Matthew Macklin this morning about some of the shots you get caught with, because obviously he boxed Golovkin, didn't he?
Yeah.
Some of the shots that I stayed up from hurt more than the shots I went down from.
Yeah,
exactly the same with me. It's the weirdest thing.
Yeah.
So, I look back at some of the tape sometimes, some of the shots that caught me with, how come I didn't go down from that?
Yeah.
It's just, it chips away at you. But I don't see myself as brave, because this is a world title fight. What am I going to do? Stay on the floor? If I can get up. You forget, though. It's the weirdest thing. You forget. So you're on the floor. So one of them, I've seen the tape, and I'm it's a body shot. And I'm curled over, and you can see my face grimacing, like I'm in so much pain. It's not a wind in me, it's just cracked my rib. I'm in pain.
Mm.
And then all of a sudden, you hear eight. Like, you're someone else in your mind at that moment, because of the pain. You're someone else. You're not in the boxing ring. You're not in a fight. You're just on the floor in pain. And then you hear eight. And all of a sudden, you go, the panic that you're going to lose the fight. And you get up somehow. I don't know how it happens. I don't know how it happens, because you go, no way of getting up. No, I don't see images of people or nothing like that. No one whispered in my ear, get up, buddy. It's just you, the wanting to win. You don't want to lose. Who wants to lose? It's fucking shit feeling. You want to win, and you want to try your best, and so there's more in you. So you keep going. So there's nothing in you, and that's what I did. And I got hammered, but I took it like a man. I got beat up, and what am I gonna do? I tried my best, and I will fight him again the next week.
Well, you still go down as brave in my book. Yeah, I mean, maybe you had a moment like Tyson did in the 12th round. So you just something dragged you up. But, you know, I suppose maybe it paved the way nicely for you to become, you know, in your role now, you know, until you'd lost a love for the sport, but you still had the passion and you're still knowledgeable about the game. So maybe that's helped you transition into being a pundit and the commentator that you are today.
I think if people think I'm good, not everyone thinks I'm good, I would imagine, but you know, you can be what people suit you or whatever. But I think what's made me, if I am good, let's just say I am good for the sake of the conversation. I can't say that, can I? That makes me arrogant. But I think if I am good, what makes me good is that I wasn't the best fighter. So, you know, I think you studied the game more. Look at Dave Caldwell. Didn't have a great career as a boxer, to be honest. He wasn't rubbish.
Well, Central Area, I think, maybe, or something like
that. You know, on the scheme of things, that's an achievement. Good luck to him. But, I mean, on the whole scheme of things, he wasn't that. But he's turned out to be, it looks like he's a good trainer. Yeah. You're good with what talent you have, but like I keep saying that, but he looks at, he knows the game, so you know, he's learned the game because he had to study it because it didn't come natural to him. Joe Calzaghe would never be a good trainer. He knows the game and he can impart loads of knowledge to you, but to be truthful, he just could do it.
Yeah.
He don't know what he did. He just did it. Like Carl Frost can't make you tough because he's just tough. Just born that way, you know, that's just how it is. You know, you're just born with what you've got. So the rest of us have to work on our craft and try and get as best as we can, get as close as we can to these top fighters who have things naturally. We all got natural talents, but some people's are stretched further than others. And I literally squeezed every ounce of my talent out to get where I was as an amateur more than a pro, but yeah, I used everything I had to succeed. So I think it helps me now because I know what it takes to get to relatively close to the top, and more importantly, what you lack to get there, and what you need to work on, and so when I'll see where people's feet are wrong, because you can see their feet are wrong, and that's why they're not doing stuff. And so I don't think I'd be a good trainer, but I think I'd be a good Angelo Dundee. Just come in the last couple of weeks and take all the credit and the money.
Yeah. Well, I enjoy listening to you on the commentary. I mean, I commentate on like the local Northwest shows, and that's enough pressure. Yeah. You commentate on these massive, massive, massive fights, Tyson Fury versus Deontay Wilder. Do you ever feel pressure going in there? Like everyone's listening to what I'm saying.
I don't do social media very much. I got an Instagram account, but I'm really just a voyeur, just looking at the people's outside. And I don't do Twitter anymore. I haven't for a few years now. And I got Facebook. I don't really count that. It is social, but I don't really count that because it's not a really vicious arena. But that used to be horrible with Twitter, and because you'd be worried. You used to check Twitter all the time. Pundits still do. They're on their phones all the time. Paranoid. I don't look at my phone. I turn it off. And obviously, because I don't do Twitter anymore, it doesn't matter. You could be honest with yourself. But sometimes being involved with the big fights is what it's all about. Live boxing is the best feeling in the world. Like, I love other things I do, podcasts and, you know, things like this are fantastic. You're talking about the passion you love. Boxing is my first love. Like most boxing, it's your first love. And like every first love, it breaks your heart, it frustrates you, makes you angry, but you're drawn back to it all the time. You know, it's just the way it is. And I was out of boxing for a long time, and I was drawn back to it. But the big fights, though, being in like Caesar's Palace, that's wrong generation. Being in the arena across the road. Yeah, and also the new place across the road, being in Madison Square Gardens, and working there was just like awe-inspiring for me. Doing like Golovkin, Canelo, within both those fights, you're just like, this is surreal. But actually, they're not always the best fights to work on. Some of the local stuff is actually more enjoyable to do.
Yeah.
The big fights are the biggest buzz, and after it, you're like, yes. But some of the other stuff, like you get a real good night in New York Hall, and you go, wow. Or you go to Belfast and do a show for MTK there, and you just go, oh, what was that all about? In the Ulster Hall, just go, oh, I could do one of these every day of the week. Some of those smaller shows are great.
Yeah.
It's raw. The boxing's raw.
Oh, there. I love it.
They're not getting fortunes. It's for the love and ambition to get somewhere else. You know, Tyson Fury and Wilder, as good as they are, they're getting millions. So, you know, well done for getting up. Because if he wins, he gets another 25 million or something.
Yeah, I suppose. Yeah. True. But I do like the combination of you, with you and John. You know, it's like a voice that just, you know, you automatically, you know, you're watching the boxing. Do you think that's going to be like, you know, something you're going to be carrying on doing for a good many years? And is that what you'd like to carry on doing?
I hope so, to be honest. But you know, this in this industry we're in, this side of the ropes, it's fickle. You just don't know. You've had some guys do co-commentary in the past and it disappeared. I've had a good run, a decent run, and I think I'm young. I'm not young, but I'm young enough to do it for another 10, 15 years. Mm. But you know, if people still want me to work, I'm freelance. You know, with Box Nation was brilliant for me because you were sort of stuck with them and there was fights every week, and that was like the best, one of some of the best times of my life. with me, Lillis and Bunce, you know, 3 o'clock in the morning, talking bollocks. You know,
I used to watch it all.
Get away with murder. It was just pure boxing talk. So that was really enjoyable. And again, just, you know, I went to Vegas to do the Canelo Golovkin fight for Box Nation, and they weren't sending me as commentary. So Alex Steamer was already out there, and they were going to try and get him to commentate with like an American name. But then I phoned the Jim McMahon, who was running the Box Nation for the Warrens at the time. And I said, listen, I can get myself out to come on Mrs. Works for Virgin. So I said, I guess I can get myself out to Vegas cheap.
Yeah.
And I'll find the cheapest hotel. Like, I mean, really, it's really cheap as well. I used to staff travel thing and all the rest of it. And I sort of went out there like that. It didn't cost them I was already getting like a retainer off Box Nation anyway. So it cost them just my travel and my hotel, which was like £1,000 less than that. Where, you know, you go out usually, it's like, you know, you go up with BT and your flight's £5,000, whatever, yeah. 6,000 to 8,000 just for one of you. So, you know, me and Alex is already out there. We did it at the budget. But it was good. I stayed in the Excalibur. It's like a Disney castle.
I stayed in the Excalibur, the Disney one.
Just all of it. But, you know, it was the cheapest one on the strip, closest to the T-Mobile. I didn't stay in I could have stayed in a nice hotel, but Box Nation were on a budget, so you were all chipping in to help out, you know? I sort of look back, wish I'd never done that now. I could have stayed in a nice hotel if it turned out. But either way, just to get out there, they were quite fun times. And yeah, so it's not all glitz and glamour, but some of the BT gigs you do are fantastic. I do some stuff for Sky now, or the podcast and Sky Sports News on a Wednesday, before obviously all this happened. And that's, again, seeing the other side of the street, if you like. It's quite interesting.
Yeah. Well, you know, long may it continue. And I've got to ask this one, Barry, before we sort of go. Tyson Fury, Deontay Wilder, the second fight, okay? In your voice was the sort of elements of you were kind of shocked at times. I know I was, what I was seeing. You know, did that sort of, when you see something that you don't expect, does that still sort of conjure back, you know, why you love the sport and, you know, make you feel like a little kid again, so to speak?
Yeah, that you knew it was a special night. It was one of the greatest wins for a British fighter abroad. It really was. You do, because my age and older than me, you always look back. I can't see a better win than Donald Curry.
Lloyd Hannigan.
That's the best win to me. That's always in my mind. Nothing tops that. I don't give any other fighter an opportunity to top that. And a generation just before me will say Stracy and Napoli.
Yeah.
Well, Napoli, because he went to Mexico, boxed a Cuban, who was a Mexican legend, really. And, you know, and went there in a bull ring and he beat him. He stopped him on cuts in 6 rounds or something. So, you know, that goes down as in history. But that is one of the greatest. It was just like, what am I seeing? Because, I think I said to David Hay, and on the night, if Fury would have said to you the night before, I'm going to go there and put it right on him, you would have slapped him in the face and said, behave yourself. You don't box him. Just don't box him. Don't be silly. Don't take a risk. He did everything he shouldn't have done, and it worked perfectly. You walked away from that night. It's like winning a world title, but it's such a buzz. It's so much of a buzz that it's almost not enjoyable. Does that make any sense? Not like a wedding. I don't know if you've been married. Like a wedding.
I'm married, yeah.
It's so much that you can't enjoy the day because it's too much coming out. It's too
You're
big.
Right, yeah.
It's too big of an occasion. And that's what winning a world title is a bit like that. It's your lifetime ambition. You win it. It's too much for you sometimes, and you just can't really enjoy the night. You enjoy it over time. And when it involved in great moments like that, certainly was, that was a bit like that. That was good, wasn't it? That was good. It was good, unbelievably good, yeah. I thought, I'm knackered, I'm going to go to bed. We sort of went to bed quite early. Like the other Vegas trips we've had, we've been out all night and had a really good time. That one, we sort of all sort of, drifted off a little bit, you know.
It was an anti-climax because he battered him so bad, you know, with no disrespect to Wilder, he battered him so bad that it kind of was a bit of an anti-climax in a way.
I don't think it was. It was at the time as it was going live, I'm just going, what's he doing? Like, this is just brilliant, just brilliant. This is beyond good. I said something in an interview a while back about Fury. I said, he has the potential to be a great, but he's nowhere near a great yet. No, he's nowhere near a great. And that night you thought, oh, this is just a great fighter. Like, this is just an all-time great in the making. Whether that transpires, who knows? You know, but for what he did, to come back in the first fight, the way he boxed with all that layoff, he shouldn't have been in the ring with Wilder. And I didn't think he'd beat Wilder the first time. And he got robbed. I thought he got robbed.
Oh, he got robbed. Yeah.
I thought he got robbed, my opinion. And then the second fight, I thought he just does the same thing again. He can just be a little bit, you know, a little bit neater and a little more cautious down the stretch. He wins the world title by just using that beautiful footwork, that lumbery jab. You know, but he never. He did everything the other way around. You know, and he did what Warren did to Frampton, really. He used that your game plan against you.
The play away from, yeah.
Plan you should have had, he used it against you and beat you at it. And I think, fucking hell, that's a sign of a great fighter. It was just one of the best nights ever, really was. Like, I got to admit, I've had some good nights, and that's had. I grew up around Joe Calzaghe boxing, so I love Joe Calzaghe with all my heart. You know, him and Kessler in Cardiff was just one of the best nights. Him and Lacey, you know, watching that was just like, I couldn't do that in shadow boxing on my own, let alone in the ring, what he did. And the Hopkins week was one of the best weeks of my life when I went to Vegas. It really was. You know, if anything, thanks to Joe, I met Al Pacino and things like that. And, you know, but it was just like, you know, and it wasn't the greatest of fights, but to see a kid I knew, a Welsh kid with his name up in lights in Vegas, was like, and I love Joe with all my heart, was like me being there. You know what I mean? I was like a dad. You know what I mean? I'm living through you, sort of thing.
Yeah. But
the Fury thing was like that. It was just it was up there with some of the greatest moments in my career, I guess, whether it be boxing or behind or commentating. It was one of the greatest nights ever. I think that'll be hard at the top.
Yeah.
Maybe him and Joshua might be equally as good a fight.
Well, what a great place to sort of just finish then. Okay. So most people I ask, don't forget I'm based in Manchester and we go to his old amateur gym a lot and I do interviews with the boys there. So we're kind of a bit biased, really. We all say, you know, Tyson's going to win, but can you see an argument where Joshua actually wins? Can you see an argument for it?
I can't, no. I think you underestimate Joshua at his peril. I think he needs another fight or two, Joshua, to be honest. I think against Ruiz, he boxed perfect. He boxed so well, and I was so happy for him. And, you know, it wasn't a masterclass or whatever people say, but he did the right thing. Tactically, he was spot on. But he still looked like a man who was a little bit tentative of getting hit. Like we all are. We all are, of course. But you could see it was visible, too visible, that he was wary of getting hit. And at that level, at that weight, it's a worry. And also, how is he going to beat? He needs to be the old Joshua, the ferocious Joshua, you know, that intimidating character. You know, he needs to be that character against Joshua, against Fury. Because he's not going to outbox Fury. Not a million years. He couldn't do it. Though Joshua is nice and neat, and I think he might have more success than Wilder, because where Wilder, you know, is wild, I know it sounds a bit cliche, but Joshua is quite correct with his shots. He turns, you've got a great coach in Rob McCracken, so he turns from the hips and the shoulders and he punches down the line, right down the pipe. So he's correct with his shots. So he'll maybe target the chest of Fury and try and stop his movement.
Mm-hmm.
But he's such a hard target to pin down, Fury. I think Fury'd have to box like he did against Wilder a little bit in the first fight. I'd be shocked if he put Joshua under pressure and stopped him. That would be a real call, but I think he could stop Joshua, but not the way he did Wilder.
Mm.
Yeah, I didn't think he could do that to Wilder either. But I think everyone, even the people, you know, who want Joshua to win, will say that at the minute you'd have to go with Fury. You would. Mm. I wouldn't have said that a couple of years ago, to be honest.
Mm.
To be honest, when him and Price were rivals, I would have bet my house on Price.
Mm-hmm.
World title before him, because David Price did everything, but everything.
Yeah.
He needed the world champion. Kept his shape, hands high, lovely jab, beautiful right hand.
Mm.
And for some reason, David Price stopped using his jab. That's what happened.
Yeah.
I don't know if he had an injury. The two losses to Thompson, he stopped using his jab.
Yeah.
I don't think everyone really picked that up. But he stopped using his jab. That was the reason why he lost those two fights. He lost the first fight because he didn't stop using his jab. He lost the second fight because I think he couldn't use his jab, and he lost his confidence. And then he went in and looked too tentative. And yeah, but ever since then, you haven't thrown a proper jab since then. If you have a look at his fight, you haven't thrown a jab since, and there must be a reason why that is. Whether he's lost confidence in it or he's got an injury, I don't know. But like that, he was going to the top, I thought. But Fury made too many mistakes.
Yeah.
Like he's a maverick, and like every bit of maverick, what endears you to him is that in that genius, there's an air of vulnerability about him, and that's the magic. And that's why people want to watch him. He makes so many mistakes, but in that making a mistake, giving you an opportunity, he's either going to get knocked out or he's going to do something that you're going to talk about forever. And that's just the way he is.
Yeah, that's just the way he is.
In his own words, he's a fighting man, I guess. That's the
thing, isn't it? He'll fight any man born from his mother. Barry, is, but you know what? It's been an absolute pleasure. I could speak to you all night, but you know, I really appreciate you spending the time because I know you don't do many of these interviews. So I really, really thank you for your time, and hopefully we can do this again and a bit further down the line if you wouldn't mind and touch on some areas.
I would. I tell you what I would like though is to talk about other fighters because
okay.
It's great that people have a backdrop of all us fighting. No, and we all like, you know, we all got an ego. It's great to talk about myself. You know, I'm my favorite subject, but you know, they're like you're yours. But I've had my time. My time's done. I ain't coming back. And the same with everyone. We're all getting pats on the back. Let's talk about these other kids coming up. They need the exposure. Whether you get them or not, I'm happy to talk about them because I just think I want to talk about people. I want to be seen. I need to be relevant to keep my job.
Okay, well, we'll do that next time. We'll talk about some other fighters. But today, you know, I really did want to talk about you and your career because I don't think the story gets told enough, really. But yeah, I would love to take you up on that, Barry. Yeah, definitely.
Thanks, Sammy. Have a good time. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. And like I say, I really cannot thank you enough and appreciate your time, really. So, take care, and I know you're not on Twitter, but I'm going to put this interview on Twitter and all everywhere. So, but you know, it'll get out there, and hopefully, people will appreciate what you've said today.
All right, then. You take care. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks very much. See ya.
See you, mate.